Hello, and welcome to Rock, Paper, Swords, the historical action and adventure podcast. My name is Matthew Harvey.
And my name is Stephen A. Mackay.
Stephen A. Mackay! Yeah. We're both best-selling historical fiction authors, and together we chat about all things historical and anything that could fall under the banner of action and adventure in books, film, TV, and games.
And we also talk about rock music sometimes.
If you'd like to help us with our running costs and get exclusive bonus episodes every month, a free copy of our book, tips on writing, publishing and marketing your book, and other cool perks, check out our Patreon page.
And if you enjoy the podcast, please leave us a 5-star review wherever you can online and share our posts on Facebook, X and so on to help us get the word out there. It really helps the show grow and attract more big name guests to interview.
Quinn is the New York Times and USA Today best-selling author of historical fiction. A native of Southern California, she attended Boston University, where she earned a bachelor's and master's degree in classical voice. She's written 4 novels in the Empress of Rome saga and 2 books in the Italian Renaissance, before turning to the 20th century with The Alice Network, The Huntress, The Rose Code, and The Diamond Eye. All have been translated into multiple languages. Her newest novel, The Briar Club, tells a powerful story of female friendships and secrets in a Washington, D.C. boarding house during the McCarthy era. It is out in July 2024. Kate is one of the headline speakers at this year's Historical Novel Society conference in Devon, UK, and we're both, Stephen and I, looking forward to meeting her in person in September. But until then, welcome to Rock, Paper, Swords, Kate Quinn.
Welcome, Kate.
Thanks so much for having me. It's lovely to actually put some voices behind the names I've only interacted with on the internet.
And did I get the list of books right there? I mean, I fluffed all the lines, but did I get the things that you've written correct?
Yes, all that was good. The only thing is it's Southern California, not Carolina.
I've written Southern California and read Southern Carolina. I'm obviously just dyslexic.
I've actually interviewed you before, Kate, back in 2015 via email, and you were promoting Lady of the Eternal City at the time, a book I read and enjoyed, but it seems like a lifetime ago. So now many... Sorry?
Oh, goodness, it does. That is a lifetime
9 years. So many years and books later, you're about to publish The Briar Club. So can you tell us a bit about it?
In a nutshell, it is about a boarding house, all for ladies, which is a house full of very different women with really nothing in common, who start being pulled together when the latest boarding house member joins the little family and starts actually pulling them together into something a bit more than just a lot of strangers who are ships that pass in the night. And what the women are going to find out over a weekly supper club that starts to form around this their newest member is that they have something more to offer each other than just, you know, occasional squabblings about who gets the restroom, and that they all have secrets, however, and some of those secrets are deadly.
Oh, nice. Uh-huh.
Interesting. So I noticed, obviously, as I read out in the introduction as well, that you've turned from sort of the distant past and an ancient world and medieval world and Renaissance world to the more modern 20th century. Still historical, but much closer to the present day. I'm actually listening to the audiobook of The Alice Network right now, which I think was the first thing that you wrote in the 20th century. Is that right? It's sort of based in the 20th century?
Yes, it was. Before that, everything I'd written was Well, for one thing, it was all set in Rome. It was all either in ancient Rome or in Renaissance Italy, based around the papal Rome. So yes, that was Alice Network was my first 20th century foray.
Right. Okay. So, and it's great. I'm really enjoying it. And the narration's brilliant as well. So the actual story is great, but the narration's really good as well, which is an important thing when listening to an audiobook, as I think everyone would agree. But the book was chosen, that the Alice Network, as a Reese Witherspoon Book Club pick. And I watched the little video clip of you chatting to Reese Witherspoon. I was very jealous. I was thinking, man, that'd be great to be interviewed by Reese Witherspoon. But how much did that experience change the trajectory of your career?
Oh, goodness. That really was a game changer. I mean, I heard about it when I was quite literally in line at Vancouver Airport coming back from, I think it was actually some book events that I'd had after the Historical Novel Society conference in 2017 in the United States. And I'm being pinged by everybody I know. And I see that my book has popped up in an Instagram reel with Reese Witherspoon, where she's saying, I'm going to have a vote all my readers for the book club can pick the July 4th of July book club book pick. And so there's 24 hours and three books. One of them was mine. And the shriek that I let out in the middle of the TSA line, I'm surprised I was not immediately yanked to one side for a cavity search, but I had about 20 minutes before my flight departed and very sketchy airport Wi-Fi to get online and put this up and basically beg anyone I had ever met in my entire life to vote for me. And I did happen to win that vote, and that was wonderful. So everything else jumped in. I am amazed. And I continue to be amazed by, you know, how many people jump in, you know, when, you know, someone like Reese Witherspoon says, hey, this is good, you should give it a try. But it definitely did change a lot of things for me. And, you know, I continue to be absolutely grateful for that. And the fun thing I did find from that little, you know, chat that I had with her was that, you know, it's very easy to tell. And I'm sure you gentlemen know this as well. It is very easy to tell if someone is interviewing you about your book, whether they've actually read it or whether they're just riffing off the talking points on the back. And it was very easy to tell that she'd actually read it, and she'd read a lot of other things. My TBR grew a foot in the brief time that we talked, because she had so many books that she wanted to read and had already read and was dying to talk about. And that was a fun thing, because, you know, I think a lot of us can think when we look at a celebrity book club, well, it's probably just a photo op, right? You know, how much of the reading do they actually do? And I can actually say, she does the reading.
That's funny. I was speaking to my wife about it last night, because I was when preparing for this interview. My wife reads a lot as well. She's a librarian, and she loves reading. And I commented about how I watched the video with Reese Witherspoon, and I actually said, you could tell that she'd read the book, because actually it's the book that I'm listening to as well. So I said, you can tell she's read it, because I could, you know, she's talking about characters that appear in the book, and she's, you know, I haven't finished the book yet. I haven't finished listening to it yet. So I could tell that she knew the story quite intimately. It was clear that she'd enjoyed it and that she'd read it, which, as you say, you could tell very clearly. And Stephen and I, obviously, we interview lots of different writers and different people come on. And I mean, I don't know about Stephen, but I'm a really slow reader. And mm-hmm. There's no way that I could keep up and read all the books of all the people that come on, as well as, you know, write and do all the reading I need to do for the day job as well. So, you know, we're quite honest about it, that we haven't read everybody's books. But you're right, it really does show when somebody has read the book and they really do know what they're talking about.
Yeah, that's impressive that she did read it, because, as Matthew says, you know, we just don't have time. I tried, when we first started this podcast, I tried to read everybody's book before we interviewed them, but it's just impossible. So that is, I like Reese even more now than I already did.
I know. Come on, give us the skinny here. Is she as nice as she appears in everything that I've ever seen her in?
She was lovely, I have to say. I mean, I do not have any celebrity horror story here. She was really lovely and was not interested in being sucked up to. And her whole team was very lovely as well. So it was a really great experience. I mean, like, I don't know how it happened. I mean, like, I had no connections that, you know, got the book into her hand. I don't know how it happened. I don't know how it ended up happening that way. So it really was as much a surprise to me as to anybody else, but I am very grateful for it.
Yeah,
that's really inspiring, then, because we all hope for something like that to happen. So it just shows us it can.
Just as a matter of interest, I mean, because that was your first sort of 20th century foray, in writing. And since then, I think all your books have been set, you know, in the 20th century. Is that a conscious decision because you picked up so many new readers then and you decided, I'm going to run with this? This is the way, you know, it's going to be great for my career. Or is that something you're already planning on doing, or a bit of both?
Both. And but it was also the fact, I think, that I finally figured out really what it was that I was interested in writing about. And, you know, it's like this only happens, you know, 7 books in, you know, I'm a slow learner, clearly. But it's one of those things where people have asked me, how is it that you can, you know, why do you write books in such different eras, you know, literally separated by thousands of years? And really what I figured out, the thing that pulls all my books together, is that I am interested in fundamentally less a specific historical era. There's actually many, many historical eras I adore that I would love to write about. But I'm interested less in a specific historical era than I am in the ways in which women in the past and people without power find ways to carve out little spheres of influence and independence and, you know, agency for themselves when they live in eras that do not want them to have it. That is the thing that really interests me. And the thing is that you can find women like that, people like that, in any era, regardless of where you're looking. It's just as a matter of sort of digging around the edges and finding them. So once I had realized that, it's like, that's really the common denominator that all of my stories that I want to tell have, I sort of realized that, you know, I'm not bound by any one particular era. And so therefore I do take into consideration, what does the market want, you know, in terms of, you know, what kind of stories are people interested in? Because, you know, I love ancient Rome and I love Renaissance Italy, but, you know, as we all know, historical eras tend to come and go in cycles. I mean, just as an example, when I started writing my very first book, which was Mistress of Rome, which is set in the first century imperial Rome, Gladiator had just come out in theaters the summer before. And so everything ancient Rome was hot. And I thought, great, I'll catch the wave. I did not catch that wave. Spoiler alert, because, you know, it takes a while to write a book and then find an agent and all that stuff. So ancient Rome had time to go out of fashion and then come back into fashion, because the time I came back and was and actually sold that book, HBO's Rome was airing. And I was like, yes, finally, it's back in again.
Because so HBO's Rome probably came as a result of Gladiator, then took 2 or 3 years to be produced and, you know,
cycled out. Yeah. So it's one of those things where history, historical eras tend to come and go in cycles. I mean, you know, 15 years ago, anyone at the Historical Novel Society could tell you, you couldn't sell a World War II book to save your life. People just weren't buying it. But then after a while, it seemed like all anybody wanted was World War II.
It's funny, I remember in 2016, I was in the Historical Novel Society in Oxford, and someone asked, there was a whole panel about, you know, what's the next big thing? And they asked agents and they said, World War II will be. And that was in 2016. So,
And, you know, for a while it was Tudor, because, you know, Philippa Gregory came out and it's like suddenly everything was Tudor for a while. So historical eras tend to come and go in popularity. And I do. So therefore, I do tend to take some consideration as far as what do I think I can sell? Because, you know, I would like to not only write a book I like and I enjoy writing, but I would also like to be able to pay my electricity bill.
Yeah.
So you take these things into account. But on the other hand, I don't think I could ever write in an era I just flat out was not interested in. So it has to be something that, you know, will grab my attention and that I can really dig into and enjoy. But, you know, something also hopefully that I won't, you know, tell it to my agent and I'll get that desperate look in her eye where she says, you're pulling my leg, right? You don't want to, you're not really writing that. So I try to find the sweet spot between the two. And fortunately, I'm really interested in many, many different historical eras. So I have pretty much always been able to go back sort of to the toolbox and think about something every time I hear a new era that I hear is hot. I always end up thinking, could I write something in that time or not? Now, I am hearing that the 70s are big, and I have to say I am not interested in writing anything about the 70s. There's way too much shag carpet, and that was hard enough to live with as a child of the 80s, and it's hanging on.
I was going to say, I was born in 1971. I don't want to start writing about my own childhood. That's...
No.
Kate, we're obviously in the same wavelength here, the three of us, because you just answered, I think, 3 of our questions that we had written down before we got a chance to ask them. So we're messaging each other saying, oh, what next? And you've replied, you've answered each one as we've been doing it. So
that's why if you saw me sort of start to smirk while you were talking, I tried not to, but it's because he's been insulting me by my messaging. He's been sending me messages telling me I'm an idiot. Like, but anyway, because I asked the wrong question or something anyway. So yeah, this is we shouldn't show behind the curtain. This is behind the curtain of professionalism.
Oh yes, because writers are deeply serious and professional people, and there's never anything that you end up doing like, you know, you're spending all day in your yoga pants that are covered in dog hair, and, you know, because
it's every day.
Oh yes, absolutely. Have you ever seen those? You know, I see sometimes these spreads in magazines. It's like, you know, a writer at home, and it's somebody like in dry clean only silk, and I'm just thinking that is not any writer that I know. It's like sweatpants all the way.
Yeah.
Definitely. Yeah.
I watched some of the BBC Maestro like masterclass stuff, and they've got Ken Follett does a masterclass, and he's very interesting actually, because he's talking about how to write bestseller type fiction, which is really, you know, what I think probably all three of us is sort of what we want to write, not literary stuff, but much more sort of really great storytelling and punchy stuff. So it's actually really interesting. But obviously, I don't know if it's actually filmed in his house or in like on a set somewhere. But like you say, I mean, he's very pristine and with a lovely rug and, you know, paneled walls and his books. And you know, it doesn't really look like where most people sit to write. I can't imagine he does really. But anyway.
Well, I remember during lockdown when Zoom started becoming a thing with Zoom meetings, Zoom book clubs and things, I realized after a while that I had, you know, the Zoom outfit, I thought of it as hanging on the back of the closet, which was where I had, you know, like a nice, you know, like button down blouse and like a necklace and, you know, a hairbrush, so I could, you know, and like a pair of earrings. So, you know, it's like pretty much very quickly, you know, with about 5 minutes notice, I could, you know, whip off whatever coffee stained t-shirt I was wearing and, you know, like put on the button down and, you know, quickly smooth the hair and you put a pair of earrings on, and I suddenly look very serious and professional, but only from the waist up.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Below, you know, it's still, you know, the fluffy slippers and, you know, the yoga pants with dog hair on them. But I think everybody was doing that after a while, where it's business, but it's only business from the waist up, where the people on Zoom can see you.
I'm going to make no comment about business from the waist up, because that's just like, that's waiting for me to make a joke about. Just not even going to go there.
Right. We'll skip to this one then. How do you go about your research, Kate? I imagine for the books set in the USA, you can visit locations, but what about the stories set in distant locales? And you mentioned, I think, before we started recording, that you've got some weaponry, like swords and stuff, so I assume that's part of your research as well as fun.
I research sort of before, after, and during, you know, the whole writing process. I mean, when you're sort of just digging into a book, that's when you're reading everything you can get your hands on, whether it's, you know, like I grossly overuse the buyers who bought this book also bought X book, you know, feature on Amazon, so that I can, you know, get my own copies of things, because I love to underline and dog ear and, you know, make excited little notes in margins. And so, you know, usually saying something like, use this.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I do as well.
And, yes, exactly. And so that's a big part of it. And then I do try to go places if I can, but, you know, that's not always possible. I remember when I was researching the Alice Network, I did not have it in the budget that year to be able to like go to France and, you know, rent a vintage convertible and drive around France to recreate the road trip that happens in the book. You know, that would have been nice. That would have been great. It was not in the budget. So I sort of veered the book towards some places I was a little more familiar with, so at least I had some memory to go off of. And then after that, you know, you rely heavily on, you know, Google Maps and vintage photographs. And honestly, vintage photography can be almost more useful to a historical novelist than going somewhere in person, especially if you're talking about places that have been severely eroded by time or destroyed by a war. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you're looking at, you know, writing in the ancient world, you can go somewhere and, you know, nothing is there is
yeah.
the way
even
it looked back
we've talked
then.
About this in the past. You know, even things like coastlines have changed, river courses have changed, buildings have gone, buildings have come and gone. You know, everything's changed. Roads have gone, aqueducts have disappeared. Whatever it is, the whole look of a place can change drastically.
And the same thing, you know, when it's a war that you're talking about, you might stand in the middle of a square and think, well, I'm standing where my heroine would have stood, but everything she would have looked at has been bombed flat. So everything now is rebuilt. And, you know, sometimes, you know, things just, you know, travel is not in the cards. You know, I wrote the book about Lyudmila Pavlyuchenko, who was known as Lady Death. She's the most effective female sniper in history, much less World War II that we know of. And that was during lockdown. It was my lockdown book. So even though it was only in Washington, D.C., where she did a Goodwill tour, and I had quite a lot of, you know, quite a lot of the books set there, I could not travel there. No one was traveling anywhere. So I was quite literally plotting a sniper duel out on Google Earth, because that was the only option that I had. Now, what I did do for that, and you did mention, you know, I do have a sword collection. My husband and I are both sort of aficionados. There's a lot of swords. And the movers always end up laughing at us. I'm in the process of moving at the moment. But I also, I did end up getting a, it is a Mosin Nagant World War II era with PE sights, which is what she would have used. So at least I couldn't take it to a range because, you know, again, no ranges were open, but I could at least get the heft of what the weapon felt like. I could run a drill with it. I could, you know, immediately see like, okay, this is, you know, how heavy this is and how, okay, I can see from the bolt action that, you know, this would be very easy to operate with heavy gloves, really good in very, very cold weather on the Eastern Front. So things like that are good because it's hands-on, even if you can't, you know, sometimes get as hands-on as you would like to do. And anyway, for those who are worrying, that's not one of those, you know, crazy dark web sort of things that you have to do to get something like that. There were millions of those that were produced. So it was a very easy transaction as far as research goes. And it was, there are a lot of those around. So,
it's a real one. It's a genuine, like, what is that, a World War II gun?
Yeah, it's a genuine World War II rifle. And right. That's the brand, it's the variety that she would have used. So I used that and I was able to, that gave me a lot of good hands-on research for that kind of thing. For the latest book though, it's a little less, gruesome than that. I had a lot of cooking in the book. So I'm lucky enough to live with a very good cook. So he field tested all the recipes that I had in the book, which was kind of fun. But yeah, it's always amazing what research you end up doing. And it's actually one of my favorite icebreakers when I'm talking to writers who I've just met, is like, what is the scariest or most troubling thing that you've ever had to research that you are positive has landed you on a list somewhere? Because my God, we are all on lists.
Yeah, you've gone and answered
the next two questions again. Amazing. This has never happened before.
Back though, what is the thing that you have? What is the thing you've researched that's landed you on a list? Because I'm sure you have a story.
Man, well, everything I've researched is how long does a body take to decompose? I mean, those sort of things, or what are the? I don't know. Sometimes I search things like, you know, what are the symptoms of a stab wound to the stomach, or you know, things like that.
Yeah, poisons is one, isn't it? Ancient poisons. What's a natural poison?
Yeah, what grows in a hedgerow in England that you could use to poison someone and kill them, you know, things like that. I mean, there's lots of stuff. Yeah, actually, I have poisoned people in the books as well.
Mm-hmm,
yeah,
so true.
Yeah.
How long does it take for someone to bleed out after being stabbed, you know, in the between the ribs?
Yeah.
That kind of thing.
Yeah.
I actually did have a thing for one book, and this was one where I honestly was a little worried because it wasn't just a Google search. It was the fact that for a book, I had to actually consult a firearms expert because it was for my book, The Huntress, because I had to consult a firearms expert because it was a question I did not know. And so I was literally trying to figure out how to compose an email to someone I had never met who did not know me.
Without sounding like a psychopath, basically.
Without sounding like a psychopath and ask the question, I am trying to figure out how to rig a 1930s era shotgun so it would blow up in someone's face, but look like an accident. And I was just trying to figure out how to word this, you know, in some way that would not make me sound like I was going to be on a headline for, you know, bumping off my spouse or something like that.
You can imagine the firearms expert just forwarding it onto the FBI, just going, I think this one's for you guys, you know.
Yeah, I will say the first guy I tried never called me back. And I cannot honestly say that I blame him, although he did not call the cops on me. So I remain grateful.
Yeah. This question is one close to my heart, as I'm currently working on the plot for my new book, and your novels often feature intricate plots and interwoven storylines. So how do you keep track of all the narrative threads and ensure that they come together seamlessly at the end of the book? Because that, for me, is difficult.
I wouldn't say it comes very easily to me either. I actually don't think I'm very good at plotting intricate mysteries. And I tend to, you know, start tearing my hair whenever I really kind of get into the weeds on it, because it does not come naturally to me. And so generally what I rely on is critique partners who can be counted on at the rough draft stage to say, didn't you kill this guy back in, you know, chapter 31? And then, you know, I'm like, yep, but in my defense, I was hoping you wouldn't notice that. And they do notice, and they call me on it. So honestly, I think I rely on other people to tell me of that, because I think the problem with plotting intricate mysteries in books is that we are bound by what is plausible as novelists. Mm-hmm. We have to think, will the reader believe this, that this can happen? But real life is not bound by that. So therefore the defense of, well, this actually happened, is actually no defense, because human stupidity, frankly, knows no bounds. And, you know, things like the power of, you know, coincidence and fate to make, you know, the most bizarre things happen, you know, pretty much if you can imagine it, it has happened at some point. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, you can't use the same logic in a novel where things actually have to hang together in some way that at least purports to make sense. So I really do count on, I tend to, you know, have things that braid together through various timelines. And it's always one of the things that takes a number of drafts for me to get right, because you need to figure out if, you know, you're seeding those breadcrumbs of clues, you know, too heavily or too sparsely or not at all. And you need to figure out if your mystery makes sense. And when I'm stuck, I tend to rely on the idea of going on a long walk, ideally with somebody who I can hash it out with. And sometime around, you know, maybe like the second mile marker, hopefully we've hashed out an issue or we've hashed out a solution.
Yeah, it's a good thing. Talking it out with someone else always helps, even if the other person doesn't really offer much in the way of a solution. They just are there as a sounding board. I find it's very useful to almost like speaking out loud. You suddenly go, oh, I can see how this would work. And it all sort of falls into place.
Yeah, it really does. And I think that's one way our spouses put up with a lot. And I think our spouses have gotten very good at, you know, doing that thing where, you know, they're doing that. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Tell me more about that. It's, you know, as they're thinking to themselves, you know, like when am I going to be able to get back to top gear?
Yeah. So, well, in this, I have to say, one of the things you said really struck home when you said that we can't rely on something being plausible or actually factually correct. You have to try to, you know, if it's factually correct but seems incredibly implausible, it's difficult to put it into a book. And that yesterday I'm doing all this plotting. I'm reading about the history of the timeline, and it's the fourth book in my A Time for Swords series, which is based in the late 8th century. So it's the build up to Charlemagne being crowned the Holy Roman Emperor in 800 AD. And I'm looking for the relics, and I'm looking at, there's a story is going to involve relics and searching for relics and all this sort of stuff. And
landed you on a lot of email chains where suddenly you're being bombarded with advertisements for relics and religious paraphernalia?
No, not yet. But the funny thing was that yesterday, so I've been looking for some original relics, because I'm thinking everybody's sort of, you know, the Holy Grail, it's been done to death, you know, the sword, the spear of destiny, all these things are very sort of commonplace in terms of been done in fiction a lot, you know. And so I was trying to find something original that I could hang this story on. And then I suddenly found the real life story of Charlemagne. When he's getting crowned, he actually handed, apparently, to Pope Leo III a gift of a relic which he had got in Jerusalem, which is all tying up to my story, because I've got them going to Jerusalem and they were going to get something in Jerusalem and everything. But this relic apparently was the most important Christian relic in the early medieval and throughout medieval history. And it is the Holy Foreskin. So it's Jesus's foreskin, and otherwise known as the Holy Sacred Prepuce, which apparently is, I know in Spanish, prepucio is foreskin. And I thought, oh my goodness, this is too good to be true. This is too good. I've got to use this. This is like destiny. I'm going to have to use it. And I told my wife, and she said, That's such a so distracting. She said, even though it's true, if you put that in the book, people are going to think it's like Monty Python. It's not going to feel real. You're going to get totally the wrong reaction from people. You're going to get people just laughing rather than thinking this is like an action and adventure story. And I think she's probably right. But I did argue for a while against it and said, no, it's an amazing idea. But yeah.
Well, I used testicles in one of my books as a relic because there genuinely was a relic. But the joke is that they only have one of them. And one of the characters says, well, we've only got one, you know. So the joke is they only had the one instead of the two. But yeah, they had all sorts of strange relics.
Yeah.
I think I've heard of that before. That is the whole thing of that is just that is really is too good. I would want to use it too.
Yeah, I do want to use it, but I don't know. I think it's going to be mentioned as an aside, but I don't think it's going to become the main thread of the story. Is it's just a bit too much.
Boy, the foreskin story. It's like I'm married to a sailor. You tell me a story like that, and I have they're like 12 jokes to go through my head, which I cannot possibly say on this podcast.
I know. Well, I can't even. I mean, I had all ideas for the story. You know, in the book, I was thinking like how they could it could be destroyed and they could have to get one to replace it, and how they could say, well, you're not circumcised, we can use, you know, the whole story was laid out in front of me. My wife was like saying, are you seriously going to write a book about the holy foreskin?
No, I remember there was it was a bit of research that I did too. I did at some point. It was Saint Catherine of Siena in the Middle Ages. She had this whole thing about how she, you know, like she had a dream where she was married to Christ. And, you know, there was a whole thing about how the wedding band placed on her finger was, like the foreskin. Was the foreskin.
Yes. Yes. I read that yesterday as well.
I read that and I was just like, lady, you need therapy.
Yeah. So this is
cheaper, not as shiny as a gold one.
Not going to last as long, though.
I was going to say, it's spoken like a true Scot. I'm sort of thinking ways of saving money. It's a bit drastic, though. We can't make you laugh anymore. Okay.
Right. Okay. So this is a kind of an aside, this question. It doesn't really fit with any of the others, but I was looking back at the emails that you'd sent me back in 2015. And when you sent me a copy of Lady of the Eternal City, you mentioned in passing that book piracy was a major problem. I must admit, I've not thought about it very much since then, because it seems like something we just can't do much about. But do you think it's still rife? And do you have any tips for authors on ways to combat it, if it's even possible?
I'm not sure there is any way we can combat that. I mean, it's maddening, but... maybe the only thing we can do is have some vicarious revenge. I did actually read a book where, which I gave me a certain vicarious cackle, where it featured a writer who went to a book club, you know, of rich Upper East Side New York ladies who were reading her book, and then she realized they had all pirated their copies. So then she has a very satisfied, the writer has a satisfying moment in that book where she gets up, tells them all what she thinks of them and storms out. And I just thought that must have been satisfying to write. So maybe a little vicarious revenge is all through the page is all we can do about it. I'm not sure there's much else.
No, I don't think it's really worth worrying about because there's nothing you can do.
I think it's one of those things that there probably are. I mean, there definitely are people that will be reading ebooks that are pirated. But would they go off and buy the books if they weren't pirating them? I don't know. You know, are you actually losing sales as a result, or just getting more readers that were never going to pay for it in the first place? You know, so I don't know. It's hard to know. So what's next for you? I imagine, because we know the way this works, that, you know, the books take a long time to write, then they go through the editing, and then it takes like an age for them to be printed and published. So I imagine that although you've got the Briar Club coming out in a couple of weeks, that you've already written your next novel, or you must be well on the way to completing it. Could you tell us a little bit about, are you able to tell us a little bit about what you're writing now, or what's next?
It is a little bit of a departure for me. It is something that is, I haven't talked much about it yet, but I am done with it. I finished up the, you know, absolutely horrendous first draft and not long ago, and it's about to go off to my critique partners. It's probably coming out in 2026. Not really sure yet. But it's a little bit of a departure for me. It's a bit more on the a bit more fantastical, got a bit of magic realism in it. And about the only thing I think I can say right now, since I haven't worked up my pitch about it at all yet, is that the title, at least for now, is The Astral Library.
Ooh, sounds nice. Interesting.
Yeah, sounds
anything with a library sounds good, you know. Yeah. Did you say worth stealing, Stephen?
Yeah. I wouldn't tell anybody else.
you can't copyright a title, can you? So we'll both bring out books called The Astral Library next week.
Well, we've got a whole year, Matthew. 2026 is a long way away.
That's right. Yeah, we can piggyback on that. Yeah.
Well, you'll be speaking at the Historical Novel Society conference in September, and we'll be there too, as the roving podcasters for the event, which sounds fun. So are you looking forward to it? You've done these before, obviously.
Oh, I'm looking forward to it hugely. I've been a regular at the US-based Historical Novel Society conference since 2015, which I attended in San Diego. That was, you know, right before my first book was coming out. So I knew absolutely nobody in the writing world, and I came home with about 100 new friends. And that's, right. I think, when I realized that how important community is in our particular line of work. You know, it's a very solitary business that we have, and it really does help when you can have people in your corner who you can complain to about copy edits and about missed deadlines and about, you know, the 40,000 word doldrums. And, you know, when you hit that stage and you're thinking, why have I written, you know, 8 books and I don't know how to write a book yet? You know, I'm such a hack. Well, I'm going to be a dog walker. You know, we all hit these stages, and, you know, there's only so much our spouses can do beyond, you know, the patient look and, you know, plying us with wine. So it is helpful, really. And that's when I realized at that first conference how helpful it was going to be able to have other people in this business. So I've gone to almost every one of the US conferences since, but I've never quite made it across the pond to the UK conference. So I was intending to, you know, 2020, but, you know, a few other things happened that year. And so I'm really delighted by the chance to be able to come to this one. So I really can't wait to see how it's going to be different from the US conferences and how it's going to be very similar, and to get a chance to meet you gentlemen and all the other various UK writers who I've been chatting with online for now, you know, years in some cases, and yet never had a chance to meet face to face. So I'm looking forward to being able to drink pints in between with everybody in between our panels.
Well, absolutely. Well, that's the only reason we're going.
Yeah, that's the best part.
And so I can guarantee you, I've not been to the actual location that we're going to. I've been to Devon before, and I live in the southwest of England, so not that far away. And I can guarantee that the actual venue will be different from your conference centres that you get in the US. I'm pretty sure of that.
Just a wee bit older, I have a feeling.
Just a wee bit older and a little bit more quaint and a little bit, yeah, just different. I can't imagine it's going to be the same as like the downtown San Diego or wherever the conference centre was. For the 2015 one.
No, I remember for the last conference I went to, there was like it was some big conference hotel, and there were just miles and miles of hotel corridor. And I had something like a zip that I couldn't reach, you know, by myself in my room. And there I am, you know, sprinting down about 3 miles of corridor to where my nearest friend is so she can, you know, zip me up the back. So, you know, I have a feeling this will be a little bit different.
Yes, I think a little bit. Yeah, a little bit.
We're nearing the end, but I've got this question that I particularly want to ask about A Day of Fire, because I thought that book was just brilliant. Every section of it was just fantastic. It was an incredible book. And you've worked on other projects like that since it's a book written by 6 different authors, basically, for anybody that doesn't know. But it all hangs together and it just worked so well. But I was just wondering, how does it actually work? When it comes to writing it, does one person take the lead coming up with the overall idea, and then the rest of you fit your stories around that idea?
For a continuity novels, which you think of as sort of like a novel in 6 parts, that's rather than being an anthology of short stories, it is, the whole idea is that you'll take a certain historical event and then divide it into, you know, however many authors you have, and then you divide the timeline of that event into it. So therefore, everyone writes their own section And the idea is that each individual section can stand by itself if it's read by its read alone, but it has to be, when read A to Z, contribute to, you know, the overall arc of the entire story. Right. And that means that you have to do some very careful cutting. I remember for A Day of Fire, which is six authors telling the story of the Vesuvius eruption that destroyed Pompeii. What that really meant was that you couldn't go with your immediate instinct, which is, as a writer, is you're thinking like, oh, great, I get to show that eruption, and what am I going to put there? But the first thing that we ended up thinking was only one person can show the eruption, or else if the reader sees the mountain erupt in every single story, it starts to feel like Groundhog Day. Mm-hmm. So therefore, you have to craft the novel so that the earlier sections still have, even if they're leading up to the eruption and the lava and everything else, even if they're leading up to that, they still have urgency and excitement. And the later stories, even if they're happening after, you know, the disaster has occurred, they still have enough lead in that you're not being dropped totally unaware into a story that where you have no idea what's going on. So it did take a lot of very careful plotting, but that's the fun part in a lot of ways. And you need to have people who are willing to be flexible and who are going to be willing to be consider it as far as, you know, let's brainstorm, let's put this together. If I can't show the eruption, what can I show? And, you know, putting all that together meant that you need to have people who can really work together and really have fun with it. And that, when it is working well, really does make it a very fun time for writing. And we had a great time doing that particular novel. It was the first one really that we had, that we did, and we're still very proud of it. And who knows, that we've always thought that would make some kind of, we daydream that, you know, maybe it'll make a great miniseries or something like that one day. Who knows?
Yeah, imagine getting the budget for like an HBO's Rome, but for something like that, you know, that would be great.
It would need to be a big budget, right enough, for everything that happens. But,
one can but dream. Mm-hmm. But it's not the first time that Stephen's mentioned that. Yeah, he obviously really had a big impact on you, Stephen.
Yeah, I'm sure I was actually in tears reading it. I mean, it was a depressing time for me personally because we'd lost a baby. But that book, you know, it sticks in my head. Yeah, but not in a bad way. It's just, I was a very emotional person at that time, and reading that book, it was kind of, you know, it just made me even more emotional, but not in a bad way, because I think I took a lot of hope.
Well, sometimes you need something to sort of unlock your emotions. Mm. I think we've talked about this as well, not specifically about that book, but how books don't change, but readers do. And that book maybe found you just the right moment that you were the right, you know, for you it was the right book at that time, and it really impacted you. So
yeah, it was like an 8-book.
I've actually found that reread. That's why I like to reread. And I know I've met some people who say they never reread anything, but I actually find that it's fun to reread your favorite things because you're not the same person.
Exactly. That's right. Yeah. We're different. The book is a constant. The book doesn't change, but we change. And so you read a book 20, 30 years later and you're a totally different person. Effectively, it's like reading a new book because you see totally different things.
Well, it's like, you know, when you're a teenager and you read, you know, if you're a teenager and you read Romeo and Juliet, you think it's the most romantic thing ever. And then, you know, you read Romeo and Juliet in your 30s and you're like, oh God, kids, what, you know, for the love of God, will you just slow down a little bit? And nope, you're not going to slow down. You're going to, okay.
Yeah. And if you, I suppose if you read it as a parent, you know, you probably just think, oh my God, I can imagine you and my kids being this stupid and going off and killing themselves. You know, I mean, it's just terrible, you know, terrifying, really. So, right, we're coming to the end anyway. It's been wonderful talking to you, and thank you so much for coming along, and especially as we know you've got a bit of a cough and you're recovering from a cold, but thank you for persevering and getting on and speaking to us. But we've got a couple of questions that we always ask at the end. We ask everybody. So the first thing is, what have you been reading and watching recently?
All right. Well, I actually have just, I've been reading a lot of Claire North lately, and I'm hoping to get to meet her when I come to the UK. I've just read The Last Song of Penelope, which is the third in her trilogy about Penelope and the wife of Odysseus and how things really went down in Ithaca while he was gone. Wonderful, wonderful series. I also just finished an N.K. Jemisin's Broken Earth trilogy. I love a good fantasy when I'm in the mood for it. And that one has been on the list for a while. It was just superb. Absolutely great. And speaking of rereading, I actually just reread Guy Gavriel Kay's Lions of Al-Rasan, which is, you know, Guy Gavriel Kay is just fantastic. And that is, you know, fantasy, but it, as he said, is fantasy with a quarter turn to the right. You know, it's really telling the reconquest of Spain from the Moors by the Spaniards, but it's with a slight fantasy twist on it. And, but it's, the history is very recognizable and just a wonderful book. So just as good on a reread as it was the first time around.
Yeah. That's on my reading list. I've had that on my list to read for a long time, but I've never got around to it. So one day.
I noticed in your Goodreads of the year, Kate, that you'd read something like 150 books or something last year, I think. I don't know how you manage that. I'm lucky if I've read two or three novels in a year.
The only thing I can say is that I don't have any children and I really don't have any other hobbies. I just read and I write. So that's probably the reason.
Yeah, well, I think, I'm definitely, we could have a whole podcast about this, but there's definitely ways of reading and speeds of reading. So my sister and my wife both read incredibly fast, and my mum as well. And I do wonder, they definitely read in a different way than I read, because I can't read as fast as they do. And I know that they still get everything out of the book, so it's not like they're skimming and not reading it properly. So there's just a different approach to reading, and I'm definitely a slow reader. But hey-ho. My wife's amazed when I tell her that I can hear all the voices of all the characters in my head when I'm reading. She says, "What do you mean? You pronounce like every word?" It's like, I said, "Yeah, well, how do you read if you don't do that?" And she's like, "Well, I don't do that." It's... Anyway.
I do that too. I kind of see it playing in my head like a movie almost. You know, people are talking, people are moving around.
Yeah. Oh, wow. Yeah.
Well, we're on to our last question, Kate. Two questions. What have you been listening to lately? And do you listen to music when you are writing?
I do listen to music when I'm writing, and I do better with that. I really can't take stillness. I need to have something in the background. I do like music. So I tend to like I listen to a lot of, when I'm writing movie soundtracks. So, you know, when I was writing about ancient Rome, you know, I had HBO's Rome soundtrack on the background. I had the Gladiator soundtrack on in the background. For the Briar Club, which is my latest one, I had a lot of 1950s classics going on. So there was a lot of, you know, Rat Pack and a lot of Elvis and, you know, a lot of rockabilly and stuff like that. So music of the period is good for sort of immersing yourself in the time. So that's been what I've got right now. And then who knows what it's going to be next, because I'm sort of thinking about what I'm going to do next up.
All right. Well, good, whatever you choose to write next, best of luck with it. I'm sure it will be a massive success. And looking forward to the Astral Library, which sounds intriguing already. So, best of luck with everything. And looking forward very much to meeting you in September. And looking forward to hopefully attending your talk as well, hearing your talk in the Historical Novel Society.
Well, looking forward very much to meeting you gentlemen as well. And I will say, first pint is on me.
Oh, brilliant.
We'll hold you to it.
Absolutely.
Well, thanks, Kate. Thanks for coming.
Thanks very much, Kate. Cheers.
Oh, thank you so much. Lovely to chat with you.
That's it for today's episode. We hope you've enjoyed it. Don't forget to leave a review and subscribe. And a special thanks to our Patreon producers, Luke Gauchy, Adam Turner, Ben Mayer, and Andy Maxwell.
And let us know if you have any questions or things you would like us to cover in future episodes. You can find out more about our books on MatthewHarvey.com and StephenAMackay.com.
The theme music is written and performed by us, and we own the copyright too. Until next time on Rock, Paper, Swords, it's goodbye from me, Matthew Harvey.
It's goodbye from me, Stephen A. Mackay.
And remember, whatever action and adventure you have going on in your life, be kind,
stay safe,
and happy reading.